Howdy, folks, and welcome back to Let's Play Shadowrun Hong Kong. As per usual, we're just jumping on here, and we have some people to talk with. We've got Mo Nebby over here, Breaker Wee, and, I believe, Keita. We'll talk to Keita later, probably once we're getting ready to go down into there, but for the time being, we're just going to speak with these two really quick and stick our nose into the little Soi Kai building here. An imposing troll stands in front of a stall overflowing with weapons of all sorts. Pistols, rifles, and even brass knuckles overflow onto the rug around him.
Oh there. You look like a man who understands the value of self-defense. Breaker Wee at your service. I can promise you I can help defend yourself. What do you say? Want to take a look?
Oh yes. Yes, 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 yes. We're next to Broke. Yes. Spiked fists. Alright, some fragmentation grenades. Can I see what I have? No. I would be tempted to get a fragmentation grenade if we didn't have two grenade launchers in the party at the moment. And flashbangs aren't really worth too much either. Alright, so that's all we want from you. What about you? What's your bag, Mo? The man in front of this stall is rooting through a box of music chips with the swift fingers of someone who knows what they're looking for. Behind him, a music player pumps out a constant stream of distorted atonal music. The stall's proprietor is nowhere to be seen. Can you believe this? Got four bootlegs of Echelon 60, the unreleased Enoch Ian Keys, a double chip show from Bowserville, but absolutely zero chips from Shotgun Bloom. The stall's stuff is purely second rate. Hey man, don't get down on Echelon 60. I saw them when they played that unlaced show at the old Chocotart factory out in the Soon and Wan. The show was amazing, even if the police had to break it up midway through the second set. The music aficionado waves his hand dismissively. The show might have been great, but come on. Echelon 60's old news. They're already being mainstreamed. I saw a trid ad for the new Mitsubishi Austro scooter. They were using Main Volt Under the Bus as the backing music. Made me sad, I tell you. Oh man, we got a music hipster. The Decker inclines his head politely toward you. Monebi at your service. Decker, technologist, music fan. You're not from around here, are you? You don't hold yourself like a native. No, I'm not from Wampoa Garden, no. Runs his hand through his hair, shaking the collected rain off it. Thought so? What brings you out here? I'm trying to find out who's been killing the elders. He pauses a moment, face falling. Well, that's nasty business. I heard Tong died tonight. I don't know who or what they pissed off, but it seems like a really bad scene. I'm trying to keep my nose out of it. Still, I like this place. Is there anything I can do to help? You know anything about the MERS? I'm trying to stay as far away from it as possible. I'm not connected enough to hear anything important. All the talk about monsters is just plain dark. I'm not afraid of monsters, but I want to get to their attention. All I know is that a couple months ago we had Elders Nakamura, Yutande, Gan, and Magpie, and now we don't. About Magpie? Sounds like she was kind of vicious. Be blunt, she's a hateful, shrewdish old badger of a person. It was always her way or the highway. She butt heads with other elders over damn near everything. Last plate she had was with Tang over something or other. I guess she ended up throwing some of his microdrones into a deep fryer and threatening to kick his ass around the block. I like this woman. What was her line of business? Matrix gear. A shop called the Jack Point. Not very imaginative, I know. She had the hottest programs, best chips, and made some killer decks for anybody willing to pay her rates. Cost plenty of Nguyen, but she was one of the best in the business, at least in Hong Kong. If you want to know more about her, you should talk to Zippy. He's one of the other people around here who got along with Magpie. You can probably find him by the MTR station. What's that steam bun cart over there? Alright, we've already spoke with Zippy. We talked to him at the end of last episode. What about the Wampoans? Your collection of freaks, geeks, nerds, and tech junkies. This place may look a little look like a third world bazaar, but believe me, we have stuff here that's cutting edge in almost every field. He swells with pride and plants both hands firmly on his hips. Maybe it's not as advanced as the stuff the Megas have in their developmental labs, but it's as advanced as anything you can find in a store. People come from all over the world to buy and sell here and work out deals for big shipments. We've got contacts with every pirate and smuggling group in the South China Sea, and every major syndicate and gang in the Free Enterprise Zone knows not to mess with us. Only there are a lot of us, nobody wants to lose what we're selling. The Red Dragon made a play 4 years ago, but we chased him out. He gestures with both hands as if shooing away a bothersome insect. Scooted off back to home on tin, and they've never been back. That sounds dangerous, he must have pissed them off. It's about playing the angles. Yeah, pissed them off, but then we sold goods to the Yellow Lotus at a discount. In exchange, Yellow Lotus cut them off our back. You don't have to beat up the big guy to win, you just have to make him step back so the other big guy sees he's off balance. Stand up fights for the mages. We're about survival, just like everybody else in the shadows. Mages, eh? Well, I'll see you later, Mo. I don't really care about your areas of expertise. You already told us that you're a music aficionado and a decker, so let's see. Let's see what's going on in the jackpoint. Open server and a display case. It's been as full of assorted chips, peripherals, and add-on modules for cyberdecks. They don't seem to be arranged in any coherent fashion, they're spread across the felt surface. Eh, we'll troll through it. You sift through the display case, searching for anything that might prove interesting. Isabel peers past you into the bin as you search. That's interesting. There are a lot of storage memory, I.O. handlers, and active memory in this bin. Seeing any MPCP hardware, response increased chips, or anything related to the hot shit decking Magpie was supposed to be into. In fact, you couldn't even build a full deck with this. Thought the MPCP would be just a glorified comlink. And what do you think that means? Well, if I had to guess, I'd say somebody cleaned her out. MPCP, response increased, biofeedback filters and all that. They're easy to move, expensive, and highly illegal. All the rest of this crap is good, but it's nothing you can pick up at any electronics shop. You have to know what you're looking for, though. Only a good decker would know what they're seeing. Could Magpie have taken him with her? She gestures towards one of the other displays, a pair of small cyber decks sit inside the locked case. I guess so, but if she did that, why would she leave the completed cyber decks? No, I think this was theft. Alright, so somebody's been stealing from her. The front of the server's case hangs open, the inner machinery quiet and without power. A clipboard is stuck to the side by a piece of duct tape. Its paper is filled with a long list of programs and their prices. A quick glance over the program sheet reveals names like Bugs 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 and Black Hammer. Undoubtedly, this was Magpie's attack program storage machine. Somebody removed the drives, and it sure wasn't Magpie. Here, look. She gestures to the innards of the open server. Near the back, a solitary red light blinks. The main drives were disconnected properly, but it looks like she modded the server to have a backup drive with its own battery-based power supply. Who does Magpie should have taken that too? Crap. This is a Fuji XB1000, and it looks like battery power ran out a while ago. The XB1000s are constant write drives. They're dirt cheap and have a ton of capacity, but if they run out of power, they lose their data. We're not going to be able to get anything off the drive. Alright. Desk. Gotta search the bathroom. You search Magpie's bathroom. There's not much in here. A toothbrush, toilet paper, some hairpins, and a collection of cheap makeup. Combination bath shower unit, however, has minor flakes of a dry reddish substance near the drain. Blood. Dried blood. Prying open the drain cover, it looks like quite a bit of it was shed as well. Well, shit. Maybe Magpie didn't take a trip after all. With that amount of blood, I'm guessing someone killed her quietly, then drained her body in the bath. Make it cleaner to relocate. Doesn't match the other killer's scenes, though. Thinking there's a lot going on with these murders than we initially thought. First, they don't even mention Magpie to us, and now it looks like she's been killed. Something's not right here, Devon. Let's not mention this to the elders. If they're hiding anything, they may start cleaning up their tracks better. Probably smart. Let's check her desk. Magpie's desk is the kind of messy most people only associate with rats' nests, hoarders, and deckers. The surface of the desk is littered with cigarette butts, half-finished cans of soy calf, and scraps of electronics. A towering pile of empty instant noodle bowls sits next to it. Their sides are blazing with the Honest Wang's instant old-time Lamian, and depict a line of top hat-wearing caterpillars dancing with canes. Hey, awesome! I didn't think anybody but me liked Honest Wang's noodles. Flavor like you never tasted in a package of instant noodles, I promise. She taps the side of one of the containers. See? This one's cheese curry broccoli. I don't know why it never caught on, honestly. Probably because it's disgusting. Duncan shoots you a sidelong glance, mumbling Seto's voice. Seto voce? I don't know. It's not a phrase I'm familiar with. Also, there's a helicopter in the background. Yay! Living near an airport. Just gonna go ahead and let that pass here. Good enough. Gee, who could pass up the delicious taste of cheese, curry, and freeze-dried vegetables? God seems oblivious to Duncan's sarcasm. I know, right? People out there have no idea what kind of culinary delights they're missing. Jesus Christ. We searched the desk. You gingerly root around in the desk, doing your best to avoid the more disgusting piles and spills. It isn't easy. The desk drawers are stuffed to overflowing with receipts, cigarette packs, optical chips, and cables. Most of the contents are boring, useless, and disgusting. While searching one of the bottom drawers, however, a low-quality tin lockbox catches your eye. Someone has pried the latch off, leaving a ragged hole where the lock should be. The interior of the box has several sleeves for storing key cards, all of which are empty. A small note is taped to the interior of the box. Spare stockroom keys. The doors in the rear of Miss Yang's restaurant. Do not lose these. Use only if I'm not available to open the stockroom. A stockroom, huh? So who broke the lockbox to get the keys out? Probably whoever cleaned out her equipment. Thinking you're right. Whoever tore the latch off the box was in a hurry. Any of the elders could have cracked the maglock without too much trouble, and most regular Wampoans could too. Seems like somebody who's tossing the place and wanted to get in and out as fast as possible. If someone was going after her gear, her stockroom would be a gold mine. Alright. Well. Objective added, find a key to her stockroom. Oh, this is... I don't know if it's worth... Nope, can't do anything there. I'm gonna check her bathroom again, see if that has maybe, like, maybe if that will allow us to... Alright, we can't. Alright, well, I guess in that case we're done here? Maybe? Alright. So find a key to her stockroom. That is... Like, I wouldn't even know where to begin to search for that. Down here, shall we? Hey there, Keita. Are you going to warn me away from the parking garage? Oh, I love that F5 is just defaults to quick save in this. It's so great. This dumpy looking man is busily hawking a variety of grilled spherical treats of various sizes. Some are sold individually, some are skewered on sticks, and some are packaged in sets of 4 or 6. A sign on the front of the cart reads, Keita's One Yen Yatai. A cacophony of small trid screens are attached to the cart, each playing a different trid show. Interest you in some dango, tokayaki, maybe a nice nikuman. That's a pork bun with a Japanese twist. Any kind of tasty Japanese treat you can imagine, I've got it. Maybe some curry fish balls are your speed. Keita will give you to your heart's desire, providing that your desire is on my menu. Sure, let's have some dango, why not? Yo, which is my command, good sir. He deftly pulls one of the dango sticks out of the cart and drops it onto the grill. A small robotic arm slides out from the cart and begins turning the stick until the balls of rice flour are a toasted brown color. Lifting them from the grill, he dips the entire stick into a tub of sticky brown sauce before handing it to you. The snack has both a sweet and salty flavor reminiscent of sesame seeds and soy. The balls inside are pleasantly warm and surprisingly chewy, a bit like eating raw dough but without the attendant chalky taste. He leans back, studying you intently. The trid projections from his cart cause his face to be lit in a constantly shifting array of rainbow hues. So it brings you to Wampoa Garden, my friend. Somehow I doubt it is just the street food. We'll be honest, I'm looking into the killings of the Wampoan elders. He shivers, wrapping his arms around his body. I've been hearing a lot about that. Haven't looked too closely, though. It's none of my business, you know? Got any thoughts on the murders? Yeah, ignore them. He shrugs indifferently. Saw the crowd down at Tong Sensory Carnival earlier tonight, but I didn't know the guy very well. I'm a Trid fan. He liked The Sims. Not a lot of crossover between us. Oh yeah, what's up with all the Trid screens? He beams and gestures excitedly at them. You like them? I love Trid operas. Chinese, Korean, Japanese, Indonesian, it doesn't matter. This way I can watch all of my favorite shows without missing a beat, and I can work at the same time. Pirated Trid is my other business. I rip the streams in the Matrix, tap right into corporate feeds, and resell them on a chip out here. His face falls a bit and his enthusiasm wanes. I wish it could pay bills, but my food cart's a lot better at that. I don't know why, but most of the other Wampoans seem to like Sim over Trid. They don't know what they're missing, though. One episode of Thousand Cranes of Autumns and they'd be hooked for life. I'm just at the part where old Rin has confessed her love to Takeyama, and he's got to his mech suit out on the front lines on Mars, so he can't be with her. Downright heartbreaking, I tell you. Yeah, that sounds interesting enough. Eyes twinkling, he leans forward in breathless excitement. Oh, you have no idea! 312 episodes chronicling a noble mech pilot and the tumultuous love affair he has with a space station governor's daughter. The pathos, the majesty, the Battle of Lagrange 1 spans 5 episodes just by itself. For some reason, I guess it didn't resonate with the wider public. I don't know why. Why doesn't anyone want to see a Trid show about giant flying robots, love, betrayal, and spies? I've got to stop myself before I get carried away. Was there anything else you needed? Nah, I'm good. Oh, future anime fans, you go. Oh. Is this gonna end in a gunfight? I'd be okay, because these guys are all armed. Actually, there's a lot of people in here. Seven. Something up there. Alright. Where's the aggro point gonna be? Can I just, like... Oh, seriously, you're not gonna let me, like, just open up on these guys? That's far enough, guy. The woman hefts her weapon, tossing a nod towards the gangers behind her. This lot's our turf. If you're looking for a fix, you're welcome to trade, but if you're not here for business, clear the hell out. You try and wander around in our turf, and we're gonna have to air you out. So what do you say? Looking for a little pick-me-up? A little nitro give you some pep? Maybe you want some chips, take that edge off. You want it, I got it. Some of those BTLs you're selling looking an awful lot like they came from Tong's shop. Yeah, so? What do you care? Well, if you stole these from Tong's, maybe you saw something I can use in my investigation. Yeah, I guess that's fair. It's like this. Broken Thumb Yuan was walking down the street and sees this guy go into Tong's shop right at closing time. Tall guy, hunched over, had this shitty gray rain poncho draped over him. Now Yuan figured it was weird as hell, so he posts up and waits. Figures the guy'll come out soon, cause Tong's closing up shop. Nothing for 15 whole minutes. Guy comes out, hustles down the street, nobody saying boo. Figure he was waiting for an ebb in the crowds. Yuan sees some blood smeared on the door though, so he goes in to check. Inside, total carnage. But you know what? Tong's not gonna be using his gear anymore, so to hell with it. Yuan jacks a lot of it. Business is business. You're damn right it is. That's all I know. Guy had to be the killer. Tall, gray rain poncho, hunched over. Also smart about how he came and went. And telling me about what happened in the fight here? As far as I know, some police showed up looking for somebody. They got in here, all of them got killed. Whoever they were after was long gone by the time we showed up. Used to be a lot of Wampoans living here. They all cleared out, muttering about ghosts and shit like that. Have you heard anything else about the murders? Nothing much. Tell you what, though. I've got a guy named Kang. He was down in the storm drain system last week. Something was moving down there. Big too. Man-sized. But it wasn't speaking any language he understood. He'd beat feet back here as fast as he could. Dumbass dropped his storm drain key on the way out, though. He wanted to go looking for whatever it was. He left to get a new key from somebody else. Kang stole his from a city worker. Who else might have a key to the storm drains? There's a guy named Porter Lam who's got keys to pretty much everything. He's somewhere between a cop and a handyman. Yuan also mentioned some elf woman with crazy colored hair who managed to scam a key. Said she hunted paracritters down there, devil rats and shit. Alright, well, I guess let's see what you got then. Well, here, you know, can we look around? We'll ask. Man, are you deaf? What the hell did I tell you? No, you goddamn well can't wander around our turf. She shakes her head, mumbling something about idiots with no memory. Do you know who Kindly Cheng is? I work for her. She could do you some favors in the future. Okay, that's a compelling argument, but why the hell do you care about the garage? I'm investigating the murders of the other elders. The gunfight with the HKPF might be related. Huh, well... We're only set up here because the original occupants are too scared of ghosts and demons to come back. There's blood on the floor, so what? Bill told us it was alright if we moved in here. Seemed happy to have us camped out, honestly. We just want to sell chips, that's all. Knock yourself out. Alright. The ability to poke around obtained. Can we go down, like, into the depths? No. We have blood smears and a bloody drain. Dried blood and bullet holes pockmark the floor, pillars, and walls of the parking garage. Judging by the amount of blood staining the floor, multiple people died here. To call the scene bloody would do it a disservice. This was a massacre of tremendous proportions. Look at this, Devon. Duncan points to several scratches on the floor and the pillar. These scratches look like they're from a long-bladed weapon, like a sword or a machete. The number of bullet holes in the walls and cars around here, they must have been spraying wildly. Our killer must have fought the HKPF in here and cut them apart. Since they never found a body, I've got to assume the killer got away. He checks the chamber on his assault rifle. Tell you what, I don't want to have to fight this thing at close range. Yeah. Something with, like, hand razors or something. Dried blood and clots clog the drain. As you look closer, however, something catches your eye, an off-color red that doesn't match the hues of the gore around the drain. Bending closer, it appears to be a small nugget of some kind. Oh, God. Is it like a meat chunk? We're gonna fish it out. The nugget, upon closer expansion, is a chunk of some kind of synthetic ferroplastic. It's got ragged edges, as if it was broken off of a larger object. A number of small markings are partially obscured by scratches. Well, let's try to examine it. Brushing away some of the dust, you peer the fragmentary bit of ferroplastic. The scratches and markings on the nugget look like Chinese, but despite how closely you look, you can't decipher their meaning. After a moment, you realize the reason. Not only are the markings fragmentary, the language is actually Japanese. The characters are close enough to be familiar, but too different for you to read. Maybe an expert in armor or foreign languages could help. You know, I'm not sure who in Whampoa Gardens speaks Japanese, but Wing K Kwok has a shop down in Whampoa by himself, by where we met with the elders. If you meet anybody around there, they would know about armor, it would be her. Alright. So we have some leads, at least. And I want to see what you guys are selling. What do you got? I can't imagine it's anything I really care too much about. Yeah. Just a bunch of drugs. This might be useful. Plus one, mostly for the extra action points. Like, that's a big deal. But I don't think it's worth 200 million. I don't think we have really anything much worth selling. Now, alright. So, let's see. We'll get back out on the streets, and I think I'm going to go ahead and call it. And next time we will continue investigating. Holy crap. I appreciate, like, I have to say, like, I'm sure it's probably not the most high-action thing in the world to watch, but I appreciate how these games, like, really take their time telling the story and, like, fleshing this stuff out. I don't know. I'm sure it's not everybody's cup of tea, but, well, this is what we're doing. We'll go ahead and call it. So, thank you for watching. Hope you guys had a good time, and I will see you all next time where investigation continues. Until then.